is another guy that takes pictures of bugs, but he's even more specialized than me. Just grasshoppers. How about that?
Hey, Dan, I have to get going.
Oops,
do you want to...
Okay. I worked there a long time ago. I'm an electronics engineer now. I was an entomologist, and then I became an electronics engineer, and I'm made turning into an entomologist again.
Have you smelled the raspberry pie at all?
But is it from the machine shop?
Thinking about it at all?
Do I think what?
Are you thinking about it at all?
No, I don't know. So this is the pictures we just took a few minutes ago. Now, confession. I mean, you look at those pictures over there. I took all those pictures. I think they're fairly decent. But the proportion of pictures that are good that I can dare show, it's probably 1% of the stuff that I take. Most of the stuff is blurry, as this. too much light, right? So that's I think that's just with the regular lens and flash, and you know, that could be improved a lot in Lightroom. That's with the extension tubes. Again, I only took one picture per bug. Usually I would just go, and I would probably catch one that is in focus. That's the face. And that's with the 60 millimeter plus the three extension tubes. Didn't have the flash set right. Did somebody ask what I get when the flash doesn't work? This is what I get. Okay, that is with the SP700 flash head and the two speed light remote. Mm-hmm. So, like somebody was saying, you know, the view is much different. The color looks different. Mm-hmm. That was another shot at it. I don't remember what this was now.
Is that the ring?
Yeah,
that was what? The ring? Ah, yes. This is the ring flash. Yes, this is the ring flash, correct. And this is with the diffuser. But you don't see a whole lot of shine now. Well, I know. It's a little dark. It looks a lot better in my computer here, but I could probably add a lot of light on this on Adobe. But the thing is, the shine is gone. Okay, those are the pictures. Now what I want to try to do now is just give you an idea of real world magnification with the macro lens and then with the microscope lens. And we'll see if we can accomplish that. I use this software called Control My Nikon, relatively inexpensive. $30. And this is it. You can actually control the camera from the computer. I don't know if Nikon has a similar software or not, but this is the one I use. And now I have live view. And obviously I don't see anything because there's not a whole lot of light here. Okay. So, typically to do all this work on this table, I'm going to need a little extra light. Any light that you feel comfortable with will work. Lamps, whatever. I just have these little portable LED lights that I use. But whatever best fits you. And I like this one because I don't know the angle. It's easy to move around. So I'll give me some light. You know, without light, there's no photography. All right, now first, I'm gonna manually, I guess I can see there. I can manually adjust right now I can see the wood. And now I can go up and down, see when I can see the ruler. And there's the ruler. All right, now I'm going to move from one side to the next. This is the part that's all ugly. You go to the nice part. All right, right there. So about how many millimeters? What each one of those thick marks is a millimeter?
Mm-hmm.
22 more or less, because it's not perfect. I mean, like I said, it varies between cameras, but there's about. And those thick marks are pretty fat too. All right, now let me see if I can get this to work without any technical difficulties. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to take this times 4 lens off, and I'm going to put the times 10 on, and I'm going to replace the macro with my microscope lens and see what we see. There you go. So now I have a little bit more magnification. I just wanted to show you. That's not that much. I went a lot faster than I thought. Okay. I can actually shoot pictures with the computer. I don't know if it's going to come out, because I don't know if the flash is going to make a shadow, but I'm just going to go ahead and shoot.
How far away is that cube from me?
5 millimeters.
That's exactly right. It's very close. Now we're 5 to 10 millimeters away from the subject. So we're working very, very close. Therefore, this is an impossible setup for field work. It's only for this studio laboratory application. Now, the nice thing is, Bert said, well, why don't you just use the microscope? Yeah, you could use a microscope. All right, you can put the camera on the adapter that the microscope comes with and stuff. But to work with insects, since they're complicated three-dimensional entities, I find it's a lot easier to be able to manipulate that insect with more degrees of freedom. The other thing that I found out about the setup that I just modified is that I can actually compose the picture pretty good. Here's my model. And with this new setup over here, I can actually change the angle. So I can actually locate the insect a little bit better. And one of my automation projects that I was telling you about is, you see this is round. I actually have a little bit of a prototype that turns this thing around and takes pictures every 45 degrees or every 30 degrees. And then there's some software that takes those pictures, puts them together, and now you can actually rotate the insect and view it in different angles. So that's another application. Now, I cut this too short. Okay, I was in a hurry to get this presentation ready. But if it had been a little bit longer, I can move this camera up a little bit more. And now I can also use it facing down.
Well, you can remove the cube now, can't you? Put it on the plate itself.
Remove the cube? Oh yeah, sure.
The wood.
Yeah, I can do that.
Put the plate.
Now, this is a balsa cube. Yeah, I can do that if I wanted to.
Yeah, right? Down further.
Like I said, I have many options here. This is a balsa cube. And the reason, this has nothing to do with photography, but might as well. The reason it's balsa is because the pins go in easy. They allow me to put my insect in any orientation that I want. That's why it's a balsa cube. All right. So, that's that demo. Any questions?
Can we get close to that insect and see it a little bit?
Well, the thing is, yes we can, but we're probably not going to see much because of the depth of field. Right? So now we're really close to that insect. I mean, that insect's too big for this lens.
Yeah.
But there is some very minute flies that this is what's for. Have you heard of no-see-ums?
Yeah.
That's what this is for. Those things that bite you, you can't see. Oh, you can see them good with this.
How do you capture?
Yeah, they capture carbon. the way I capture nosemes and all sorts of really tiny little insects is by, I have a net. And I go in my backyard. I tell you, my neighbors think I'm completely crazy because they see me in the backyard with this net going like this. And I catch all these insects. Put them in a refrigerator on the freezer, and then I collect them.
When I collected bugs way back, I used carbon tetrachloride, and I know that's not even on the market, I don't think, anymore.
Right.
What are people using to kill? What do they use their killing tools for?
I don't know.
You don't kill them?
I don't know. I kill some insects if I put them in the freezer. When I go on the field, I go to parks, I go to different places, I don't collect insects. Only in my backyard. All right. I think this is the demo. I want to show you a couple of last things, and then I'm just going to leave it open for people to ask questions. And then I have another demo if people want to stay and look at it. But I'll give you an idea what it is. So I used to work at NC State as an entomologist a long time ago, and I kept in touch with some of the entomologists and people there. And I discovered that they were taking pictures of their insect drawers, their collections of insects stuck in drawers for many, many years, and people don't have access to those unless they go to the entomology museum at NC State. Well, they decided to take pictures of all these insects, and they came up with a really cool technique to do so, and that's one of the things I'm going to show you, because then I took their idea and sold it to a university in South America in Colombia, and they're doing it now over there, it's an interesting technique. That's one of the things that I call macro panorama, and I'll introduce that in a minute. I think I've already talked about the differences between the field and studio techniques, so I'm going to skip this one. I've talked about Adobe Lightroom. Now, for focus stacking, I use a software called Serene Stacker. It's an expensive software, I'm not going to deny that. There is a free version of focus stacking available, and I don't remember what the name of it is, but it is free and it's fairly good. And then the technique to take pictures of insects in drawers is based on a software called Gigaband Stitch that I'm going to quickly review next. Oh, okay. So I've talked about the focus stacking technique, and maybe some of you know what that means and some of you don't. So here I'm going to give you an example of what focus stacking is. Focus stacking is a technique whereby we use a microscope lens on the camera, and in order to get around the shallow depth of field, we simply take a lot of pictures with focus in different planes. So in that case, we either have to move the camera in small increments, we either have to focus the camera in small increments, or we have to move the subject in small increments. For the most part, bug insect focus stackers, how about that title, use the move the subject technique. You see a bunch of pictures here, they all look the same to you, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to escape from this, and I'm going to go to my B file. Here are the pictures again. And I'm going to travel through those. Notice what happens to the focus. That's why you need so many. If you notice, the plane of focus is so slightly changing from one frame to another. So the software will take all these pictures and stack them. And the result is this. Now, this this is a mediocre image focus stack. There's some amazing work out there. There are people that are doing. I'm just beginning on this technique. Yes.
Seems that if you're slowly changing the position of that insect, it's going to change the location of those specular highlights. Do you have a problem with that?
The software. Yeah, the software actually. Not only are you changing the location of the specular items there, but you're also changing the dimension of the insect with respect to each other. So the software has the capability of adjusting each image to match the one before and the one next.
How long does it take the software to?
Excellent question. It takes about for about 20 or 30 images. It takes about 5 minutes. 10 minutes maybe.
How many images were there for that
one? For this one, I did maybe 30. And I missed spots. I was in a hurry.
Because you're doing it yourself.
And I'm doing it manually. I'm doing it with this. Yeah, really, if you want to do a lot of images, you really automate this. And there's devices out there that do that. Very expensive.
Does the software assume a certain units of increments?
Yes.
Or if you have missed a few frames, it's going to tell you that this frame doesn't match the other ones? It's far away.
It doesn't tell you. It's just the result is very bad.
Oh.
No, I've had some really, really bad results. Like, why does that insect doesn't have a head? Why haven't
they? Can you use a remote release for your camera to take care of vibration? Or?
It is a very important aspect of this. Vibration is very important. So there's a variety of techniques being used, like raise the mirror, wait, and then shoot, wait in between pictures. Some people just do some very, very sturdy, like marble. There's this very, very heavy material in their vibration, and vibration sensors and whatnot. I mean, all kinds of things. So yeah, there's a variety of mechanisms to mitigate that. Okay, next. Now, this is what I'm calling the macro panorama. Now, this is a different way of taking pictures of an insect. This is actually a macro of an insect that does not fit into my image sensor. So what I do is I take pictures of pieces of the insect at 1-to-1 ratio, and then there's this software called GigaPan Stitch that hooks up all these pictures together to create one. So this is actually a huge image. And that's why they call them gigapixels, because they're images that can easily be 1 gigapixel and above for one image. This is the same technology used for Google Maps, and I'll show you in a minute some of the results of this. This is the result, and as you see, I left the edges like that because I wanted you to see the fact that this is actually the stitching of many images. I think this is 25 images. So this is 25 macro images stitched together to make one. Now, the beauty of this is that I could print this with an incredibly high resolution. I could print this as big as a wall, and you can get as close to this butterfly and actually see the individual scales. And so let me see if I have that picture. Here it is. It takes a while to load because it's a big image. Now, well, 1 second. Don't get ahead of myself here. I'm going to zoom in. And now you can see the individual scales here. In fact, I noticed, now this butterfly, I brought this butterfly with me. This butterfly has been with me for maybe 25 or more years. This is a very common, you see them flying all the time around here. This is a Yankee. This is from the Northeast, from Rhode Island, where I did my undergraduate degree, and I had to do an insect collection. And this is part of that instant collection. Now, it's been with me for a long time, stuck in a drawer. What I discovered, and I've been trying to keep take care of her, or him, I don't know if it's a male or a female. But I actually discovered on the picture, there's a little bit of mold growing on that I wouldn't have seen just by looking at it. And you see up here, there's mold. Oh, let me just show you something. You see the imperfection on the software?
Yeah.
Look at that. I got a ways to go. So I guess I can't quite publish this in a wall size yet. Oh, antenna's broken. Well, the mold is here. You see it right there?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, this is another rig up that I put together. This again is based on the North Carolina State technique. I actually have this here if you guys later want to see it function. If not, it's fine. But what we have here is a controller. This is a motorized controller made by GigaPan. Mount the camera to that, and you put the insect drawer underneath with some lights. And then you teach this controller to take pictures of this drawer. So you focus on this corner first, then you focus on the bottom corner, and you can program how many pictures to take, and then it does it by itself. It goes. So this is what you get. You get a whole bunch of pictures of the butterflies in the drawer. And then the same software that I did the macro panorama, I used to do this. And that's a macro panorama of the drawer now with all the butterflies. Well, anyway, I was going to show you that you can upload this to this address, and this essentially behaves like Google Maps, where you can just click on one of the butterflies and the image zooms into it. You can also cut individual areas of the image, label it, and then you can make a library of different insects. It's a separate library showing this, just a picture of that individual. You can click on it and go directly to the image on the drawer. So I guess I'm about to finish with this. Just wanted to let you know that I published my pictures in Flickr. I have about 1,000 pictures up there. And this is my first, I got some of these books here if you're interested in looking at them. I got some of these, I call them self-published book. It's a photo book of bugs that I did with my daughter, the graphics designer. My wife took these pictures of me. And she follows me just about everywhere I go in South America taking pictures of insects. And she's an amazing woman to support me to do this and be patient with me. Any questions?
Let's
take a picture. Yes.
Any recommendations for us laymen who want to try to identify the creatures that we're photographing?
Oh, absolutely good question. I forgot to mention that. There's a website in North America, United States and North America. It's called bugguide.net, bugguide.net. Take a decent quality, it can be point and shoot, as long as it's focused. It does not have to be a piece of art, just a good, well-focused image. You submit it to the website, and within an hour, or as fast as 2 or 3 minutes, you'll get a response from some retired entomologist out there. And there's some, heavy-duty PhD current entomologists that support that website. It's in the entomology world, it's a very well-known website. And the beauty of it is it not only records the species or the family or whatever the classification is of the bug, but it records where you took it, what month you took it. So you're now collecting geographical distribution, temporal distribution of the insects, and it's becoming a huge database. It's been on for like almost 10 years now. And there's, I think there's close to a million images stored there. I have about 120 in there.
Is there anything similar to birds?
I don't know anything about birds. That I know, but that's fine. I'm glad my insects can keep the pretty birds alive. Now, one of the reasons I do this stuff is because I wanna show people stuff they've never seen before. So, for example, it's called biodiversity in Colombia, and it says Membrosidae, which is a family of insects. They're called tree hoppers, and I put that poster in Bugfest. Last fall, and a person from Colombia, grew up in the same city that I grew up, asked me, "Are you from Colombia?" "Yes, I'm from Colombia." "You take those pictures?" "Yeah, I took those pictures." "Did you take those pictures in Colombia?" "Yes, I did take those pictures in Colombia." I've never seen those pictures before. I've never seen those insects before, and the reason is because they're so tiny. Those insects are just a few millimeters. And you really need to know where to go look for them to find them. So my goal by doing this is to educate people, to show them what a beautiful world we have around us that we can't really see. And thankfully, technology is allowing us to do that. It's important because at the same time, we're putting a lot of pressure on the environment. And so when we make decisions about how we're going to use the environment, we need to know what's out there as well. I think that's all I have. Now, I have the GigaPan equipment here. If anyone's interested, I can set it up and we can do a run with that. It would take about 15 minutes to set it up and program it. And we could see it take the pictures.
I have a question about it. Have you ever tried using a bellow system instead of the extension tubes?
No, I have not tried using a bellow system, although I've seen a lot of people that do the focus stack and use the bellows. There's probably some advantages to it because you can graduate the magnification very smoothly with that. And it's very good. I find it's very expensive.
So it might be easier to actually make one with just some rubber accordion tubing and some gearing.
It's possible. It's possible. Yeah.
Did you build your own system with the gearing there? Was that gearing
no.
purchased?
No. All of this stuff is purchased. This I bought this at Amazon. I cannot remember. I think it's a company called Abracom, maybe? Abracom. And the only thing I did myself is I cut this piece of wood. I put the screws in. I'm an electronics engineer. I'm not a mechanical engineer. But I'm learning. I'm learning, yeah. Any other questions?
That table, the XY table, could you explain that? Where you got this?
Yeah. This?
Yeah.
The idea behind the XY to be able to, well, I have X, Y, and Z. So you really want three axes of movement so that it's easy for you to compose the image precisely. So this section here will move the insect or the subject in this direction. This one over here, by moving this lever, will move the subject in and out towards the lens. And obviously this one over here moves the camera up and down. So there's many ways of doing those three movements. Additionally, there's another movement that would be rotate the subject. I can see this being applicable to people that take pictures of gems, of jewelry, any little tiny stuff that you want to take a picture of in three dimensions, you can use this type of setup. But again, there's a variety of ways of doing this. I've seen people that have this setup going up vertically as opposed to horizontally like mine, but I've seen a lot that do it horizontally. So, Suppose it depends on what you want to do.
This is something you rig up yourself, but what would it cost to have professional equipment?
Thousands. Now, the professional equipment would give you a whole lot more precision. But if you want this comparable amount of precision, I mean, I don't know if you'll pay two or three times more. It's not inexpensive. Now, like I try to look for an XY for photography, and they're so expensive. I don't know why. No, but I actually got this idea from a guy that does insect photography in Europe. He put a picture on Flickr using this. And he said, well, I got it from Amazon, so I went and looked at the price, and I said, I can afford that. So I got it. And I was going to say, oh yes, this is something I wanted to say. You know, being an expert is a relative term. There's always people that are going to know more than you, and there's people that are going to know less than you. So, you know, people who are starting in photography will trust a lot what the experts say, and that's good. But what I want to tell people that are beginning photography is don't let the experts intimidate you and prevent you from trying new things, from creating and trying and experimenting, just because maybe that's not the way it's supposed to be done. I think you should try to do things out of the box is fine. You know, if you can afford and you can try to experiment with this stuff, it's great, because you may come up with something new.
Where did you get that XY table there?
Amazon.com.
I mean, what is it sold for? Is it XY for photography? Or?
No, it's for machining.
Right.
Okay.
Adam, I just looked on Sears.com and it's available there, the exact same one.
Yeah. How much?
$109.
Oh, okay, that's a good price. Relatively speaking. Yeah, I know. You're right. I mean,
So when you're doing stack photography, you just rotate that once? Is that what you do?
It's impractical for the really good focus stacking. This is impractical. Okay. Doing it by hand is impractical. So this really has to be automated. So I actually have a circuit that does it already. It's just a computer control. Allows me to set the number of steps, you know, how many micrometers per step, where to start, where to end, and actually that my control Nikon software can be connected to shoot this with the sensor as well. It's got an option to shoot the camera with a command from a sensor, so the whole thing can get automated. You can just set the beginning. Set the step, how many steps, and say start, and it'll do it on its own.
For those extension tubes, what kind of magnification are you getting per each one? I mean, I know it depends on the size of it, but for like a 12 millimeter, what X do you get?
I could not answer that question right now. I've made a table of that,
okay.
And it can be calculated. But it's not a whole lot at the end, you know, because for example, if you think about without the extension tubes, I'm getting 1:1. Mm-hmm. When I add the three extension tubes together, I only go up to 2.3. So that's kind of a ballpark of what I'm getting.
Okay. You encounter this phenomenon or when you're outdoors on a calm day, at least in North Carolina, there's an insect sitting on top of a flower or a leaf. Exposing your macro lens to the outdoors sun and causing the wind to start blowing.
Yes. That's an easy answer. Yes.
Always.
Well, you know, field work is tough. And, you know, what's most disappointing was when you're in front of this rare, beautiful insect down in the Amazon basin. You spend a lot of money on airplane tickets, on guides, and everything to get to the one point there where you have this incredible animal in front of you. And you shoot, and your camera's turned off.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's happened many times. It doesn't bother me anymore because I know that there'll be another insect in the next plant. But a lot of funny things happen like that. Taking pictures of insects, whatever, flowers. And
when you're in the Amazon, and like when I was in the jungle and trying to shoot like a little girl, I was having so much trouble with my lens fogging in. Do you have any suggestions for that?
I don't have any suggestions for that.
In Panama?
Well, I haven't had that problem, and I've been in pretty humid rainforest.
I use cat crap. Actually, it's a liquid called cat crap.
Like, oh, no.
Where do you find a cat in the middle?
You can get it at REI. Okay. It keeps your lenses from fogging up on them.
Yeah, that's happened to me in butterfly houses.
Yeah.
When only because my lens is at a different temperature, is cold.
Right.
But if I don't know when the lens has been at the same temperature as the outside, I don't see condensation on my lens. You must have been in some really humid environment. Well, there's different kinds of rainforests. Yeah, and I've been in the rainforest of South America, and in the Amazon basin. I also was in the rainforest of Chocó, which is western Colombia, which is supposed to be one of the most humid places in the world. They say it rains 360 days out of the year, and I was there 5 days, and it rained all 5 days. It doesn't rain all the time, so it rains for an hour or two and then stops. But basically, after all the time and money I spent to go there, I had a very little number of images simply because of the rain, you know. Any questions, any comments?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.